you want to follow up about what I'm going to present today, you can use this hashtag, transgenic learning. It's used just to define the bottom line of the speech of today. You will understand later in a couple of slides, okay? Transgenic learning is the hashtag for Twitter. If you want to contribute to a special issue focused on learning analytics and open education, which is also related to the topic of today, this is the call for papers to the Journal of Distance Education, you know, 40-year-old journal. And the special issue will be focused on analytics with open data. So you are welcome if you want to contribute the data. I'm coming from here. This is Europe, just in case you are a little lost in the space. This is Spain, also with Canary Islands, which is not in the map. But this is my part of Spain. And this part there is La Rioja. La Rioja. I come from Universidad Internacional de La Rioja, International University of La Rioja. La Rioja is pretty simple because it's where the best wine in the world lies on, okay? So you can go there anytime, you're welcome. My university is a fully online university with so far 27,000 students, 1,000 faculty, and 500 staff, 140 undergraduate and graduate programs. We have premises in Spain, a couple of cities, La Rioja and Madrid, and also in Colombia, Bolivia, a number of countries in Latin America, and soon to come in the States, in Florida, I guess. We run a number of European-funded projects, 17 projects so far, and also other funded projects across worldwide, and a number of things, okay? I say this just to, of course, the self-promotion, because someone has to pay this, but the point is that we are fully online, okay? Really important for my bottom line afterwards. If you want to know about what we discuss, what we work on, usually, we work on these two things, educational technology and educational innovation. With the usual cloud tag, with the usual keynote words about formal learning, learning analytics, user interaction, methodology, the things that we usually work on, okay? But the final motto, the final slogan is better learning and better teaching. We are really much focused on the user. And to us, the user is not just the student, but also the teacher. So with this background, we go straight into the point. The point is that education is one of the 17 sustainable development goals coming from United Nations and UNESCO, okay? The fourth one, quality education. But in fact, education is transversal, it's cross-topic. You get education also about economic growth, about good wealth, good health and well-being, about zero hunger, about a number of things. So education actually lies on many of the other sustainable development goals. So working on education is key for society and is key to us. This is the reason why we work and research on education. We are not just a factory of degrees. We also research to make education a transversal topic for many other aspects in society. So the current situation in education is really simple. This is the tallest cathedral in the world, 152 meters tall. Is in a village called Ulm in Germany, okay? And when the students come to the university, they usually see education like this. You start when you are 18 years old or so, and you, and I don't know, when you get your bachelor, your master, maybe another PhD, so 10, 12, 15 years ahead of you. So in principle, everything is really large. If you are part of the educational methodology, you see like this, very traditional, the Big Ben, and you should look like that. Like the kid, my nephew, by the way, the kid just reading the book with open eyes, okay? If you go into the academic management, you know, this is the usual people playing music with glasses and water. So if a drop of water is there or is lacking of water or you break the glass, the full symphony is completely disrupted, okay? So it's very fragile, everything there. This is academic management usually, a set of things that has to be in a perfect balance to work. This is about faculty members, the orchestra man, you, academic managers, academic faculty, you and I, all the time doing many things. We research, we teach, we grade, we have to go to meetings, we raise funding, we come to conferences. The usual feeling is that we are also playing a number of instruments alone just to make everything happen for the show and the puppets. Okay, sometimes the puppets are us, but well, anyway. So, and I have a solution, and this is my pitch today. The solution is called transgenic learning, okay? Transgenic learning, why? Because if you talk about transgenic, you think about food, for instance, and this is the usual definition. A genetically modified organism are organisms in which the genetic material has been altered somehow, okay? This is the concept of transgenics. Forget about food. This is a metaphor, okay? But this is the point. I'm talking about this for 10 years now, and before I call it transgenic, nobody pay attention. And now people pay attention a little more. So it's just something for the promotion, okay? Transgenic, as a metaphor. You get something, and you change it. For instance, the golden rice, okay? And this is the title of the speech today. The golden rice is pretty simple. You get the white rice, you put vitamin A that fights blindness, and you get it back to the market. So people, when they grow rice and they eat it, they eat rice plus vitamin A. Everything embedded there. And it's yellow, by the way. This is why it's called golden rice, okay? This is coming from transgenic process, okay? You have something already working, you change it a little, and you make something different, usually better, okay? This is the concept of golden rice. We need some golden rice in education. And another metaphor, it's like a Lego. I'm aware that you know what a Lego is. We all play when we were kids, or not that kids. And make a guess. You get a Lego with all the pieces in blue. And this is quite okay, but it's not that fun, because you need some color. So you take one piece, one block, you turn it into red, and you put it back. This is transgenic. This is the concept of transgenic. You take something that is actually there working, you take something out, you change it, and you put it back, okay? So, what's up about education? If you keep the metaphor, and you follow the metaphor about transgenic learning and the golden rice, you get a number of usual steps in the innovation cycle, in the learning process, in the methodological scheme or setting, and you get, for instance, the teacher training, one of the pieces. Another one is content creation, another one is assessment, and a number of things. This is just a sample of the things that you can work usually when you work in education, okay? But maybe something is not working as you were. Maybe something is not working at all. Maybe you want to change something. You don't need to change everything. You just need to change a little, because this is sort of like a clock, okay? Like a Fibonacci series. Everything is just spinning around the clock. So in every round, you get it better, in principle, better, okay? So you can take one of these and change it. So for the next round, you make it better. You improve it. You change it. You don't need to change everything. You don't need to change the clock. You don't need to change the full scheme. You don't need to kill the actual educational system. You just need to improve it. And to improve it, just take one block out, change it, and put it back. Could be assessment, could be anything else, okay? This is the concept. So it's something that already is happening. This is not new in education. We are always a little step back, okay, behind. So the point is that these things already happen in the market. For instance, this is the scissoring. It's the genetical material. You take some genes there, you change it, you put it back, exactly the same. It's already happening with in vitro and in vivo techniques, but it's already happening in society. For instance, this guy, Steve Jobs, a genius, a bad guy, depending on who you talk to. The point is that he didn't make, I don't know, really a breakthrough innovation. He didn't invent the mobile phone. He didn't invent the connection. He didn't invent any of this. He took something that was already there, changed it, made it different, made it better, and put it back in the market. It was a disruptive innovation coming from already there in the market, okay? And it's worth it. This guy, Bill Gates, maybe you don't recognize with the polar coat, because Bill Gates in this picture is not talking about Microsoft and blah, 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 and ruling the world. He's talking about a machine that turns ices into water, okay? So make the water drinkable out of the ices. What for? In Africa and in many places where this is a little more needed than here, okay? This guy didn't invent anything either. Took something already in the market, change it, and make, of course, a breakthrough. Again, Elon Musk, the car was there. He made it different and put 100,000 euros to the bill, okay? Something different. And this guy, exactly the same, Branson, Richard Branson. He didn't invent the flights, he didn't invent the plane, he didn't invent even the zero gravity thingy. He put it there, now, well, no, not, it's there, almost coming. If you have a really a huge pocket, okay? But the point is that they took something already in the market, made it different, and put it back there. It's the transgenic approach, okay? You make innovation out of a piece, not out of the full process. In education, we usually think that we have to change everything. And if you talk about political parties, this is from the right, this is from the ultra-right, this is from the left, and every time that it's changing the color, you have to change everything. Because the former guy, this guy did it really well, did really bad, and I can make it better, and I have to change everything from the root. And this is not the case. We don't have to change anything from the root, okay? So, as Albert Einstein said, insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. It seems that also Benjamin Franklin said the same. If you want to pick your quote, you can go to this place, which is called Wisdom Quotes Stories, and you can select exactly the slogan that you want to use. But the point is pretty clear. If we keep coming, doing again and again the same thing, we will not get different results, okay? And remember the metaphor. Remember the Lego, changing the color to the block. It's pretty simple. Just select what you don't like, change it, and put it back. Could be grading, could be teaching, could be anything. You don't have to change everything from scratch. This is stupid, okay? Just to make progress, to make some significant progress, you can focus on what actually is meaningful and not on everything, okay? So, in my view, this breakthrough is combining formal and informal education. This is the golden rise in education right now. It's a must to come back with a formula that makes possible to integrate everything and not to be talking, keep talking still about what is happening in the classroom and outside the school. This is stupid. Everything happens outside the school, okay? Because we have WhatsApp, Telegram, Twitter, we have a number of tools, and our students make use of this in their regular life. And yet, we think that they have to go to our learning management system to run the activity. Come on, guys. We are completely off the world. This is not possible. We have to be the other way around, in their lives, not the other way, okay? So if we can combine formal and informal through ICT, this could be really great. This could be the actual breakthrough. Why cannot we use the regular tools, the regular philosophy, the regular habit from our kids? I mean kids 20 years old, 30 years old, 15 years old, okay? And working something useful with their own rules, not with our rules. So we can integrate regular and informal just into one. This will be the actual breakthrough, okay? We will not lose our ego. We will not lose our professorship. We will not lose anything. Just will be updated to what is happening actually with our students. So, three examples and two case studies, and I finish. Three examples focused on open educational services, FADA. FADA is a repository in Arab countries focused on resources in Arabic. It combines Moodle, Mahara, DSpace, and it works. So, nothing new, it's already there, but it's the only one that I know and I'm aware of that actually works. Putting all together with a single sign-on. That's it. Middleware, you put it there, and everything just integrated into the framework, and no problem, seamlessly. It works perfectly well, okay? But the breakthrough is putting the red block. The red block is the connectivity. Everything was already there in the market. These people, the OER University, they took open educational resources and MOOCs, not just MOOCs, but also MOOCs, they put it and people can follow a full semester, I think that now is two semesters, of computer science in a number of universities, Athabasca, Ottawa, and a number of universities, based on MOOCs. So people don't have actually to buy textbooks. And when they go for the examinations, the actual grading comes from competence achievement, not just for buying the textbooks. This decreases the tuition, and of course, increases the number of people that actually enroll into the university, okay? Already there, they made it a little different. These people, El Mundo's Atlas, just places all the locations across the world with OER. You go there, it's sort of Google Maps for OER. Pretty simple, they took Google Maps, make the actual location of the OER combined together just to provide the service to the user, okay? Really simple, really meaningful and effective. If we talk about institutions, these people, Kiron, maybe you know them, they work in Syria and Germany. They take people, refugees, that actually live in Europe, and they make possible that they can follow up with their studies, with the actual credit recognition from their original countries. So they use MOOCs, so people can actually get enrolled without paying the fee and get agreements with European universities in France and in Germany mainly, just to make the actual credit recognition and people can finish in the business as a way for integration. These people can, you know, Khan Academy, I will not tell more, but it's exactly the same thing. Pretty simple things, really significant breakthrough. Athabasca University is the university I said before. You can follow computer science, the first course at least, completely with online resources, open resources, okay? Pretty affordable. If we talk about reuse of open educational resources, YouTube, why not? A lot of meaningful things there. You can use it, you can reject it, you can, I don't know, I think that the merit out of any teacher is to select the meaningful things there, the actual quality work there, okay? This exactly happens with Merlot. Maybe you know lesson plans for free, 30,000 lesson plans. You can pick your own, you modify, and you put it back. Something pretty simple. Two case studies. Oh no, I go this first. No, I will skip that. Two case studies. The first one. This is our video repository at the university. We record every week 1,700 video lessons. 1,700. Out of 9 years that we started in 2009, this means 500,000 video lessons. And we put, this is like the iceberg thingy, we put a little for open and free, a little for register and free, a little more for educational community access. So 20, 20, 60. You can get everything for free, 20%. You can get everything for free, but you have to register so I can send you later some promotion or trying to sell a course for 20%. So 40% is actually for free, okay? Out of 500,000, this means 200,000 video repositories for free. And this is the point. We are a private university, fully private university. You don't get any subsidy from any government. Every time that we put in the market something for free, cost money to us. Every time, okay? And it's working. The business model supports this. It's possible to make it happen. So what is the breakthrough here? What is the golden rice here? We didn't embed anything. We draft a business model that covers the free access for 40% of our video repository. And it's working, it's possible. This is the open policy that we wrote last year and it was signed up by every single executive member at the university. And with this policy in Spanish and English yet, so you can pick up there and go and read it, says that in 3 years, not so far now, 25% of our full material, everything, just text-based, video-based, 25% is open and for free, okay? In 3 years, 40% will be open and for free, okay? This is a commitment coming from a private university. It's a small change. It's a red block, but a significant progress, making possible that formal and informal are combined, which is the actual change for us, okay? So, a last joke. The professor says, out of the blackboard, and then a miracle occurs. And the project manager, the actual guy that makes things work, the producer says, I think that you should be a little more explicit. So we should combine both things. Okay, the daydream view, which is quite okay, and the actual practical work, meaning this, I'm drafting this business model, drafting this engineering side of view, okay, to make things happening, not just keeping with the good wish, because we are goodwilling, all of us, but we have to make things happen. We have to combine both things, okay? So, these are my contact details. Thank you so much. I will be delighted to answer any question that you can have.